All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Canada Hoops. It's your boy, Maddie. Thank you for your continued support. Please keep downloading and sharing us. Check out our YouTube channel. Find us on Instagram and X.com. Our incredible guest today represents Montreal, Quebec. He is a former Dawson College Blue, Siena College Saint, Florida Tech Panther, and he is an assistant coach at Concordia University in Montreal and the GM for the LA Ignite. And of course, he is a senior men's national team alumni for Canada Basketball, where he represented the program in Canada at the 1988 Olympics. He has contributed immensely to Canadian basketball over the years. Give it up for Dwight Walton. Dwight, thank you so much for joining us on Canada Hoops, man.
You know what, Maddie? That thank you for the introduction. That was well done. I truly appreciate it. And I'm looking forward to this conversation. As you very well know, I eat, drink, and sleep basketball. Yeah. I bleed red and white. I loved representing my country at the Olympics and on every international stage known to mankind. And anything I can give back to the sport, whether it be here in Montreal, across our great country in Canada, or just around the world in terms of my basketball analysis, whether it be on social media, broadcasting basketball games in the CEBL, coaching at the U Sport level, speaking at schools, whatever the case may be. Basketball is my life. I'm loving it. You can see the big smile on my face. It's yeah. Basketball is a great sport, man. So let's talk, man. Let's talk.
Yeah, no, well said. I mean, I know got to have a little bit of a conversation with you in Las Vegas this last summer at the showcase game. And I just remember, you know, you've been on the radar for a long time, but to get a few minutes to chat with you there, I just thought, you know, Dwight is definitely a man we could sit down with for hours, like you said, and have a great conversation about the game. And glad we're able to do this. How are things, man? Let our listeners and your friends and family and just know how you're doing and just kind of what's got you on the go right now, man.
Well, Matty, I want to tell you, it's been quite the year for me. For those of you that don't know, I worked in the Montreal school system for the English Montreal School Board for 19 years as a student supervisor. Supervisor. I'm a disciplinarian, a mentor, a big brother, a shoulder to cry on, a psychiatrist, someone to talk to. I've had many students over the years just come to me with their problems. If I may say so myself, I guess I have the gift of listening and the gift of comfort, the gift of speaking the right words to young people. I take great pride in doing so. And it's not just about basketball, it's about life in general. And I think I did a pretty good job of that over my 19-year career with the EMSB here in Montreal. And I was then given the opportunity to become full-time in basketball, if you will. My cousin, Dr. Philip McDonald, a radiologist that lives now in Los Angeles, was born and raised in New York City, a huge part of our family. He bought a team, the LA Ignite, in the basketball league.
Right.
He had been speaking about this for many years and has been wanting me to move out to Los Angeles for many years. But there were circumstances that just couldn't work out for me at that way. But he offered me the opportunity to become the general manager of the LA Ignite. And after many phone calls to my family, my close friends in my circle, I was looking for anyone to tell me not to do it. And they all told me, said, Dwight, man, do you know who you are? Basketball is your life. You're already doing this already. Your cousin now is going to pay you to do this.
Yeah.
Just do it. And again, Maddie, you know, I looked for every reason not to do it. And I ultimately made the decision to take the plunge and to do this job. And I can't say how happy I am this past year to be able to be focused on basketball as my full-time job. the LA Ignite job where I'm the general manager. And now I'm going to be an assistant coach next year. So I'll be in LA a lot of next year to be a full-time assistant coach for the Concordia Stingers men's basketball program here in Montreal, to be an independent referee, independent official in several men's rec leagues around the city of Montreal. I'm a basketball analyst, color commentator for the Montreal Alliance of the CEBL. I'm a regular contributor to TSN 690 here in Montreal on the sports radio channel and to other networks throughout the country. My reputation is out there. Many networks, many platforms reach out to me to analyze their team, the NBA, Canada Basketball, right. Just you name it. My life is basketball. And to be able to engulf myself in it full time has me on cloud nine, as you know, and people could see it in my demeanor. I'm happy. I'm at peace. I get to do this. It's not everybody can say that they get up in the morning and could do what they love to do. I truly love what I do. It's basketball. It's sports in general. If you want to talk anything sports, National Hockey League, Major League Baseball, National Football League, the NBA, obviously, right. We can have a conversation. I may be more well-versed in basketball, but we can definitely carry a conversation. And but this past year has been fantastic. The Lord has blessed me, and I just hope that the blessings continue to come, because I fully, fully feel that I can make a contribution in the basketball community. We could speak about it. I know that I would have some good ideas as to how things should go, but just the overall growth of our sport in this country is paramount to me. It is of the utmost importance to me. And with the way our sport is going right now, not only from the grassroots level, but on both the men's and the women's side, the sky's the limit. I'm proud. I can say that I've seen major growth throughout our program because I played for our program from the 80s and the 90s. And to see where it is now, I couldn't be happier. So, again, I'm in a good space. I'm in a great basketball space. And I look forward to seeing what happens for me in the future.
Yeah, I mean, I think can't put it any better than that, man. And, you know, you're a lifelong hooper, like I think a lot of us probably are. And so that's just a connector for so many people, man. And, you know, great reflection. I wanted to ask you about, you know, because of your history and time and knowledge in the game, like just it's obviously a natural to be an assistant coach or a coach or the GM role. Like how much have you just really embraced that and leaned into it to just, you know, explore a different avenue within the game? And just talk about that coming to fruition a little bit and just, you know, how much you've really enjoyed that, man.
You know, it's interesting. coaching was never really on my radar, if you want me to be completely honest with you. I just wanted to be an analyst. I wanted to be able to speak about the game, whether it be in the podcast form, whether it was sports talk radio, sports talk television. I love barbershop talk. I love engaging in conversation, whether we agree to disagree or we agree on all points. I love opinions. I love talking basketball. I love talking strategy. I love talking roster construction. But coaching was never truly on my radar. But to give you a brief history, the current head coach of the Concordia Men's Stingers program, Rasko Popovich, is a very, very good friend of mine. And, you know, I discovered him on the basketball court playing in tournaments here in the city, here around the province of Quebec. And we've maintained a friendship ever since. And John Doerr was the head coach at Concordia. And of course, I know him very well. And I was around the program when he was the head coach as well. But once Rasko took over the program, I always found myself, when I was in Montreal, whenever I was available, I was always in Concordia's gym. So I wasn't officially on the staff, but I was in the gym.
Nice.
And I was always at every game. I would go to every practice. Rasko would have me speak to the players every now and then. So I was unofficially around the program and in the program, if you will. And then an opportunity arose itself in 2017. One of the assistant coaches, Nathan Grant, couldn't go to the tournament that they were going to go to in Victoria at the University of Victoria tournament back in 2017 in October. And Rasko called me and asked me if I wanted to go. I was available. Nice. And I went on that trip. And the next thing you know, it's 2024 and I'm still on the staff.
Love it.
So that's how it happened. Of course, Nathan Grant now has gone on to be the head coach at the University of Laval. They are the reigning national champions going into this season. So congratulations to him. But that's how my coaching career got started. Yes, I work at the school board, like I mentioned earlier. And yes, I coached basketball at John F. Kennedy High School and at Lester B. Pearson High School here in Montreal. But I truly engulfed myself into coaching when Rasko Popovich gave me the opportunity to be an assistant coach on his staff. And I am still a member of his staff to this day.
Love it, man. Love it. Just take me back, man. Just a young you running around Montreal and just what life was like and just how the game came into your life and how it, you know, really started to take shape for you, man.
You know, Maddie, I say this story all the time, and I don't know, again, if it's a gift from God or whatever the case may be. And I'm a firm believer in God and the powers that he brings and the faith that I have and all that kind of stuff. It's a major part of my life. And for whatever reason, and this is the truth, ever since I was 7 years old, I wanted to be a professional athlete.
Nice.
Whether it was in hockey, baseball, or basketball. And I say those three sports in that order because that's what I played until I ultimately decided to go with basketball. I played hockey for 10 years from the age of 7 to 17. I played baseball for 10 years from the age of 7 to 17. And I picked up basketball in the seventh grade when I was 12 years old. I used to go to the park and play, but I didn't take it seriously. My late brother, Norman Walton, I love him to death. He is the one that introduced me to the game of basketball. But he loved the entertainment side of the game, the Harlem Globetrotters. He loved the Harlem Globetrotters. Yeah. I mean, loved the Globetrotters. And for whatever reason, I didn't like that part of the game. I wanted to know the fundamentals, the screen roll, the boxing out, the running the floor, all of the things that encapsulate what I am today. That's what I wanted to learn since I was a kid. But again, I thank my brother for at the very least introducing me to the game of basketball because this is what I'm known for now. And the thing is, I'm a huge Harlem Globetrotter fan now, but back when I was a child, that wasn't the case. But when I ended up going to Wager High School in Cole St. Luke, which is about 20 minutes away from where I grew up in NDG, I had two coaches, Don McEwen, Jim Aiken. There were other coaches. There was Rod Shuplin, Jimmy Butler, not the Jimmy Butler in the NBA, but Jimmy Butler back then. They taught me how to play. Don McEwen and Jim Aiken specifically. They're the ones that told me that besides my athletic ability, the fundamentals was going to carry me through. And they saw talent in me. And I knew I had it, but they brought it out of me. And that's where the love started, man. I made the team in the eighth grade, and the rest, as they say, is history. I went on to be one of the better high school players to ever come out of the city. Went to Dawson College, Seja up here in Montreal. My mentor, Varouge Gurenlian, was my coach. He also played for the national team. So a lot of the stuff that he taught in practice. He had learned from Jack Donahue, who was also his coach, right. The great late Jack Donahue. So whatever I was learning in practice, when I made the national team in 1986, I already knew. I had some idea of what was going to happen. Of course, it was a definite step up in competition, but I had the foundation. And, you know, it's of course, I had Brett McPhee, the late Brett McPhee, before that as a coach. But Varouz Gerenlian, to this day, is my mentor. We talk all the time. We had the privilege of attending an alumni weekend as the start of the training camp for the 2024 Olympic team this summer. And to see all the players from 1976, 1980, 1984, the team I played for in 1988 and 2000, to see all of those players, those individuals, of course, much older, but to have all of us in the same space with the 2024 team, it was just a full circle moment for me. And it just made me think of how I started and how I started the game of basketball and how basketball, truthfully, was my third choice. But once I started to play it, once I started to bounce that basketball and to understand the little intricacies of the game of basketball, the foundation, the fundamentals of the game that Don McEwen and Jim Akin gave to me. I will always mention those guys' names. I still see Don McEwen today. He attends some of the Concordia basketball games, so we speak there. Jim Akin, we talk every now and then on social media, but just to maintain those relationships. And it always takes me back to those two. And I'm thankful and grateful to them for teaching me the game the way that they did. And it just helped catapult me to all the success that I had throughout my basketball career. Without those two gentlemen, you would probably not know Dwight Walton, the basketball player, today.
Wow. Deep stuff. I got to ask you then, okay, who's your favorite hockey player of all time, man? And baseball.
Well, this is okay. So now, you know what? This is going to ruffle a lot of feathers because I live in Montreal. Yeah. And I'm going to bring up my late brother once again. My late brother in 1969, when I was 4 years old, he told me, you see that player right there, number four on the Boston Bruins, Bobby Orr?
Yeah.
You have to like him. And you see the team that he's playing for, the Boston Bruins, you have to like them. And ever since that day, I can't give you the exact date, but ever since 1969, when I was 4 years old, I became a huge Boston Bruins fan.
Nice.
And a huge Bobby Orr fan. And to this day, and I know we've seen great players talking about Gordie Howe and Wayne Gretzky and Mario Lemieux, who I had the pleasure of playing both baseball and hockey against. Growing up here in Montreal,
yeah,
I know how great Mario Lemieux is. I know how great Connor McDavid is, Sidney Crosby, Guy Lafleur, Jacques Lemaire, Jean Beliveau, Henri Richard. Trust me, Ken Dryden, Patrick Waugh. I can name you all of these players. But for my money, the best player to ever put on skates to this day, number four, Bobby Orr. And I believe his plus minus was a plus 328 for his career. Just the statistics that he put up for his career. Bobby, I know there's great players out there. And I know times have changed in terms of technology and all of that kind of stuff. And yes, Bobby Orr played way back in the day. But the grace, the scoring ability, everything that he put on the ice, I was a huge fan of. I think in 1975, I believe he was the MVP of the Canada Cup. He was playing on one leg. Yeah. His knee, he had, I think, 8 knee surgeries. And there was no arthroscopic surgery back in those days. Every time he had surgery, you had to cut open your knee, go in there and fix it. And that just showed me how much he loved the game. Because to endure all the injuries, all the surgeries back then, when the technology wasn't even a fraction of what it is today, Bobby Orr, for my money, is the greatest hockey player of all time. And I will go to my grave saying that. And I've seen, I am old enough to have seen all of the greats.
Right.
All of them. Right. So Bobby, you are still, for me, is the greatest hockey player of all time.
No, it's ironic he is yours, because my dad was a really good hockey player. I grew up in a rink. I grew up in a rink, never got to play, but my dad was pretty good, and he's a defenseman. Bobby was his guy too. So I often think about that, you know, and just kind of what the impact of the game was for my dad and just sports in general, right? So Bobby, yeah, doesn't get enough love in the whole, you know, greatest hockey players of all time. You know, he was,
that's my dude, man. That's my
short
dude.
Short career, but special
player. Very special. Yep.
You mentioned the alumni gathering this summer. I just want to touch on that just because you brought it up. I thought that was a great effort and initiative by Canada Basketball. Just, you know, you did mention just the ability to get together, connect with everyone. You know, what was maybe the message from the program to everyone when you were all there? Like, what, just obviously I imagine a lot of thank yous, and just for building the program over the years to get this team to where it is in 2024, but just maybe some of the conversations and the messaging just coming from the program and everyone there. Can you just touch on that? Cause I thought it was a really cool initiative, and I know it resonated with a lot of people, man.
Well, I want to make sure that I get this out there, and I've said it on other platforms. I want to make sure I reiterate it here.
For sure.
Much love and respect to Michael Bartlett, Rowan Barrett Sr., and the entire Canada Basketball front office and staff. They have gone above and beyond the call of duty in regards to being inclusive for the entire program. And they've wanted to make sure that the alumni is recognized in some way, shape, or form. When Rowan got the job back in 2012, along with Steve Nash and Jay Triano, all these players I've played with, by the way.
Right.
And we're friends to this day, and we talk often. Rowan wanted to change the look of Canada Basketball, not only on the court, but off the court. He wanted to bring diversity to the organization. He wanted to be inclusive. When he first got the job, he reached out to as many alumni that he can get to, and he wanted to invite everybody to the old Raptors practice facility back in 2012, and he wanted to have a celebration, if you will, and he did a pretty good job of that. You fast forward to this summer, 2024, it was a quick gathering, if you will. If you very well know, Rowan Barrett and his family had a very tumultuous year.
Yeah.
And understandably so, his mind wasn't on Canada Basketball for a little bit. But once he got through all of that, those trials and tribulations, he refocused and got back on track of running the Canada Basketball organization. And he wanted to make sure that because the 2024 Olympic team was in the Olympics for the first time in 23 years, he wanted to make this a celebration, a gathering of the greats of Canada. So he reached out to everybody, him and Michael Bartlett and that whole Canada Basketball organization. I can't thank them enough.
Right.
For them to be able to get the players from 1976, 1980, 1984, our Olympic team from 1988 and 2000, to get, I believe, out of the 60 players that were invited, I believe 47 showed up. Some of them unfortunately passed away. Others couldn't be there for other various reasons. And I was shocked that there were that many that came. But the mere fact that they reached out to all of those players, a lot of those players, they felt disconnected, if you will. If you're in the Montreal area, if you're in Toronto, okay, you can get to Toronto because that's where Basketball Canada is, right? Canada Basketball.
Right.
But talking about the players in BC, the players in the Midwest, in Edmonton and Calgary, Saskatchewan, and in the Atlantic, Halifax, they didn't feel as connected. But that weekend, whatever, you know, things they had towards the program, you could tell it was a weekend of healing. They got a chance to speak their voice, to, you know, talk about some of the displeasures they went through. It was a weekend of honesty, and it was just great to get together and to have the mutual respect and to have the 2024 team look at us and fully understand that there were things happening before them and that they wouldn't be able to do what they're doing right now if it wasn't for them. And if you saw the respect, if you saw the reverence that they gave us. And of course, I know these players because I'm very close to Rowan Barrett Sr. We talk all the time. We talk strategy. I'm an unofficial employee of Canada Basketball, if you will. Right. But everyone knows that Rowan and I are tight and that we're close. And I have a close relationship with RJ, his son, who's in the NBA right now with the Toronto Raptors. So we speak. And so I know these players. But I also know that some players felt a legit disconnect. But it was a coming together of all the athletes. And it was a weekend of healing. And before the weekend is over, as we were leaving, you saw a lot more smiles, a lot more gratifying relationships were cultivated. And to see all the teams just reminisce, having a great time, joking around, and just to be able to go to the practices and to see the talent that we have now. Had a disappointing showing at the Olympics, but hey, it is what it is. But because of that weeding, that weekend, Maddie, I think Canada Basketball is in a much, much better place. And a lot of the alumni feel a lot more connected than they were prior to that weekend. So needless to say, it was a very, very successful and gratifying weekend for the alumni of Canada Basketball.
Yeah, I mean, I know when it was unfolding, I just thought, wow, it's special. I could tell it was special. And Mike Bartlett is a friend of ours here and joined us a few times. And we text when we can. And
he's terrific, by the way. He's amazing.
Yeah, he's amazing. He's done a great job, him and his staff, and Ro, obviously. And, can't thank Mike enough for his support here and tremendous job. So I just thought that was great. And I remember thinking, regardless of what happened this summer with the Olympics, I thought this was a really cool thing. And you could tell the current team really appreciated it and understood the importance of it. It's good that they acknowledged that. So, yeah, I'm glad it happened. You were there, and I appreciate you sharing that with us, Dwight. Dawson College, man, legendary school in Montreal, truly one of the best schools across this country for basketball. Just, if you can, just touch on the history and just, tradition that goes with playing at Dawson College throughout all these years and everyone that's played there. Just speak on the importance of that school, man.
Well, just like the 2024 team acknowledging all of the players that built up the program before they got there, man, Dawson College, the history of that program, going back to Richie Spears and Eddie Palmacalla and Brett McPhee and Varouge Gerinlian, Pat Adrian, all these different players that I heard of before I got to the program. And then Wayne Yearwood, Trevor Williams, myself, Chris Francis, the Smith brothers, Ashley and Michael. It's so many players have come through this program. It's excellence. Right. We would have liked to have had more national champions, but the success is there. And when you walk into the gym, the banner, the 25 years of excellence, all the All-Canadians are on the wall. And now, of course, as an assistant coach, I go to Dawson College quite often to recruit players. And to see my name up there in the rafters as one of the All-Canadians, to be a Dawson College Blue is definitely a ton of respect is noticed. It is definitely a legit program. Wayne Yearwood is now coaching the men's program. Trevor Williams is coaching the women's program. These are two gentlemen that have represented our country on the international stage. Wayne and I were teammates on that 1988 Olympic team together. So there's a lot of history. A lot of great players have come through that program. A lot of great coaches have come through that program. And there are other schools here that have been great as well. But of course, you know, I'm going to big up Dawson College as much as I can. Yeah. The history goes back. They're still successful to this day. The dominance, as far as I'm concerned, is coming back. It went away for a little bit, but it's definitely coming back. And again, Dawson College is very much revered, very much respected here in Montreal and overall in the province of Quebec. But the history is there. It's you go back many, many years to the coaches that I mentioned, the players that I mentioned. A lot of great players have definitely come through that program.
Yeah, well said. I know, if you look at different high schools throughout the history, I know Dawson Sage up, obviously, but, you know, I think of, like, say, Eastern Commerce in Toronto, mm-hmm. and Dawson College in Montreal. To me, they're at the tier. They stand at the top as two of the best ever, just tradition and history. So
I can confirm that.
yeah. Like, it's, I mean, and I'm not from the East, but, you know, I'm always interested in the history of the game out there in Toronto and Montreal. And, you know, I've had guests on that played at Eastern, and they talk about the history and tradition there at Eastern Commerce. And so to have you speak on Dawson, appreciate that. And, Is it safe to say, like, your time at Dawson really set you up to play at the next level? I just want to talk about, you know, you're looking at your NCAA options and just, how'd you make those decisions, man?
Oh, without question. Like I said earlier, Varouz Gerindlian, I was coached by Brett McPhee first at Dawson College, so I want to make sure that I mentioned that. Right. But Varouz Gerindlian, because of his relationship with Canada Basketball, and he played for the late, great Jack Donahue. He was my coach, and he was my mentor. He's my mentor to this day. He has had a major imprint. I spoke about Don McEwen and Jim Aiken earlier, but Varouz Gerindlian is also a major part of my basketball success. He was my second coach at Dawson College, and a lot of the stuff that we ran on both the offensive and defensive end were what he got from his tenureship with Canada Basketball. So when I was invited to travel for the team in 86, he had prepared me for what was to come. And I am forever grateful for that, because I felt like I had a head start, if you will. Yes, it was a step up in competition, and I had to earn my respect, bide my time, if you will. But because I had that foundation from what Varouz taught me at Dawson College, it made my transition to the national team even that much easier for me. It was still difficult yeah. ride, but he definitely had a major influence on my life, and I'll be forever grateful for that. And I think that's what Dawson College meant for me, and that's what when I tried out for that team, I just thought about what I was taught and what I needed to do. And of course, all my other basketball instincts took over. I made the team in 86. I had a 10-year career with the team, and I'm still bleeding red and white to this day. As you know, if I could promote it, if I could talk it, if I could give people information, I have a lot of people that tell me, thank you for keeping me abreast of how things are going on across the country. They read my social media page, whether it be on Facebook or on X, formerly known as Twitter. Yeah. And so it's just Dawson College, man. I can't thank them enough. I can't thank Varouz Gerindlian enough. Major, major kudos to them. And they're a major part of my success, because it enabled me to have a 10-year career with Canada Basketball.
How did you wind up at Siena, like through your university time. I'd love to hear about Siena and Florida Tech and just, you know, those years, man.
Well, those two schools were heavily recruiting me when I was at Dawson College. My dream was to play Division I basketball. I had some eligibility issues in terms of there's a 5-year clock that starts if you start going to an American university. And I went to an American school. It wasn't basketball related. It was a Seventh-day Adventist school in Huntsville, Alabama, known as Oakwood College. It's Oakwood University now. Okay. They didn't have a basketball program, but I went there for 1 year. And I didn't know at the time that as soon as you start going to a U.S. school, your eligibility clock starts. So I didn't know that. So make a long story short, by the time I was being recruited to go to all these Division I schools, I only had 1 year of Division I eligibility left. We tried to appeal it. We lost. So Siena College was – I was being recruited by Big East schools, schools that were close to Montreal. But Siena College, Mike Dean and Tim Capstraw, they wanted to give me a chance. And Siena College gave me a scholarship for that 1 year. They said they would appeal my situation. They say that they did. I lost the appeal. So I had the chance to play at Siena College for 1 year. I was named freshman of the year in the conference. But I was told the unfortunate news that all of my Division I eligibility was gone because of my time at Oakwood College. I then came back to Montreal and went to Dawson for 3 years. So all those years that I was at Dawson, my eligibility clock was running and I had no idea.
Okay.
Right. Until I found out. And so I had some Division II schools that were recruiting me. I took my visit to Florida Tech. The late, great Tom Foliard welcomed me in. And he gave me a scholarship. And then he asked me, are there other players like Dwight Walton in Montreal? I said, yes, there are. And the famous story is he told me, he said, Dwight, I'm going to come up there. I want you to invite all of the basketball players that you know, find a gym. I'm going to come and I'm going to watch. And Matt, if you could see this, he was the only coach in the gym. We put a chair at midcourt on the sideline. He sat there with his arm crossed and his arms folded and his legs crossed and just watched a ton of great talent that the city of Montreal had to offer. And he was like, I want him, him, and him. And he spoke to them. Nice. They all got scholarships to Florida Tech. So there was a whole bunch of Canadian dudes that went to Florida Tech, changed the program. They went from being one of the worst Division II programs in the country to a top five team in the country overnight. Our program was investigated because they thought we were a bunch of ringers. They thought we were a bunch of pros. Where did Coach Foliard get these players from? Anyways, Dawson College played an integral role in my development, being able to get the exposure to play in the United States of America. I just wanted to play in the U.S. I grew up watching college basketball on television like everybody else did. And I wanted to showcase my talents and to let everybody know that it doesn't matter where you're from. As long as you can hoop, as long as you got the fundamental foundation and the proper coaching, anything is possible. And if not for Dawson College, I wouldn't have gotten the exposure that I got.
What did, you finish your NCAA time. What did like turning pro look like back then? Cause everyone's pro journey is a little different. Just right. take me through that. And, what leagues and teams you were looking at to start the pro journey, man?
Well, again, I want to recognize some of the accomplishments that I had at Siena College. Like I said, I was the rookie of the year.
Yeah.
In the North Atlantic Conference. And then I went to Division II Florida Tech, and I was a three-time All-American at the school. I'm in the school's Hall of Fame. I'm in the Sunshine State Conference's Hall of Fame. Had a pretty decorated career coming out of school at Florida Tech. And that enabled me to get some looks. Some NBA teams were looking at me, but I was an undersized power forward. I was 6'5 and a half, 235 pounds. I was strong. I was athletic. But not everybody is Charles Barkley. So yeah. Because of the national team as well, playing around the world, we've got agents coming to our practices. And that's ultimately how I ended up being discovered by a couple of agents from Israel. I played in Israel for 4 years. Then I played in Switzerland for 6 years. So I had a 10-year career playing in those two countries from 1994 until 2004. Had a fantastic time. Basketball overall has afforded me, Matty, the opportunity to travel around the world when under normal circumstances, I know I wouldn't have gone to any of the places that I've been to, right, if you want me to keep it real with you. And again, having the exposure from Dawson to the NCAA ranks at Siena and Florida Tech, and to have the international exposure playing with the national program, I guess it was just simply meant to be that I was going to have a pro career somewhere. Keep in mind, at the top of this telecast, I told you that since I was 7 years old, I wanted to be a pro athlete in one of hockey, baseball, or basketball. Yeah. And it was ironic that I picked up basketball in the seventh grade. And that was the sport that I truly, truly fell in love with. I've got some friends right now to this day who tell me, Dwight, you chose the wrong sport. You should have played baseball. And listen, I was good in all three sports. Could I have gone pro in all three sports, knowing myself? Possibly. I'm not going to say probably, but possibly. But, you know, it's just the journey, again, from Wager High School to Dawson, the short stint at Oakwood College, to Siena College, to Florida Tech, my 10-year tenureship with Canada Basketball. That all led to my pro career in Israel and Switzerland. I had the time of my life being able to, you know, just live in different cultures, being able to discover a lot about myself. I'm a talkative person. I'm a social person. Sometimes I talk too much, but it's just, you know, this is the gift of gab that I have. And I can put myself in any situation and get along with people. And I think that just being around the world and being able to experience different cultures just helped Dwight Walton, the person, grow as well. And to have all these experiences, basketball is the reason. And it's been a great part of my life. I have no regrets. Of course, I would have loved to have had the opportunity to play in the NBA. I played against many NBA players, but I wasn't good enough at that time to play in the NBA. But I have no regrets. I had a 10-year career. I've made a lot of people, have cultivated a lot of relationships. Just the networking and the ability to hang around some of the greats, to soak in some of the knowledge from some of the greats. I've had some great coaches throughout my basketball career, from my coaches in high school, Jamaican and Don McEwen, my coaches at Dawson, Brent McPhee, and my mentor, Varouz Gurinlian, to my college coaches, Mike Dean, Tim Capstraw, Tom Foliard, at Siena and Florida Tech, respectively. My coaches in both Israel and Switzerland. The vast amount of knowledge that I've been able to accumulate over the years, and to be able to articulate it, whether it's through a basketball broadcast or just speaking on sports talk radio or television, and to be able to be involved on podcasts like this one, I am forever grateful to everybody that's had an impact and has led me throughout this journey, throughout this game of basketball. It's been a fun ride. It's not over yet. I look forward to what's in the future for me, whether it's in the form of the media, coaching, general managing, a professional team, refereeing, you name it in basketball, I do it. And I get up in the morning with a huge smile on my face because I love this job. I love this sport. I want to do anything I can to impact the young people, just to have an impact on young people's lives, to be able to do this day in and day out, to be able to speak about it, and just to give young people hope and to know that I was like you. If I can make it, so can you. And again, I just want to thank everybody that had a part of my basketball journey. I'm extremely grateful to the coaches, the schools, my parents, my family, my friends, whatever fans I have out there. It's been a fantastic ride. I can't be more happy. I can't be more grateful for the opportunities in life that basketball overall has given me.
Yeah, I love it, man. Well said. I mean, you know, your impact has gone deep in the game, and you know, that's why it was, you know, I was excited to have you on. I got one more question before we kind of dive into more Canada basketball related stuff. But the CEBL, man, so important now in our country for a strong, thriving pro league, to have our players come back to play at home in front of friends and family. So many guests that have joined us that have played in it just love that opportunity to do that throughout the summer. And I know you call games for the Alliance in Montreal. Mm-hmm. You know, just from your perspective, like how important has it become, and how definitely was it needed? You know, could you imagine, like, if there was a league existing like this back in your time? Just speak on, you know, the importance of the CEBL now, as they, I think they're going to enter year 7, if I'm correct.
Regardless. I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, year 7. Anyway, just a great league. Just touch on that, Dwight, please.
Listen, I talk with Mike Morreale, the commissioner, often. I thank him over and over again for bringing this model, bringing this initiative to our country. It gives the youth sport player something to strive for, a goal. Like a lot of players back in the day, when they were playing in the CIAU, it was known back then, and CIS, and now U Sport. A lot of these guys, once they played their final game on the basketball court, more often than not, their careers were over. This now is an avenue for players to look forward to have a goal for. Professional basketball is huge now. I think I always say this, when the NBA came to Toronto, the mentality of the player coming out of the province of Ontario, and then it trickled down to the rest of the country was, you know what? I no longer just want to play U Sport or Division I basketball. I want to make it to the NBA. And I think the mentality shifted. And although the CEBL is not the NBA, it definitely is an avenue towards the NBA. And with the amount of players that have signed G League contracts, the amount of players that have signed NBA contracts, whether it be Exhibit 10 or two-way, or ultimately getting on an actual NBA roster, it's a lot of players of the CEBL have made it from this league. So this league is definitely recognized as one of the better pro leagues that we have in the world. It is in the summertime, and I know it's difficult sometimes to field a great team for the course of a CEBL season because of the other avenues, the NBA Summer League. There are so many different avenues where players want to play, but the CEBL is definitely being recognized. There are so many great players that are coming out of this league, and full marks to Mike Morreale and the front office staff at the CEBL to have TSN as a sponsor, to have a game of the week on TSN, to have all these games streamed by every team, giving people like myself and Mo Khan and and Gabrielle Hebert, the broadcast team here in Montreal, giving us the opportunity to get better at broadcasting. It's just the overall development, the crowds. Canada loves it. Yeah. It's following the CFL model. I think it's fantastic. I hope more teams come into the league because it's definitely a viable option for players in our country to continue their playing careers, to play at a high level, and to put some money in their pocket. It may not be millions of dollars, but it's something that can catapult them to playing high-level Europe or whatever the case may be. This type of league will give them the exposure, and it's a credible league in terms of competition to where a lot of high-level leagues around the world will look at the CEBL as a viable place to pluck talent and to sign them to their teams. It's a CEBL is a fantastic initiative, and I hope it's here for a very long, long time.
Yeah, me too. I mean, it seems like it. They've done a good job of sustaining growth every year, it seems like. And
it's gotten better and better each year. Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's more excitement. And they've done a good job putting teams in markets that, you know, are strong basketball communities, but maybe not necessarily get a lot of pro sports there.
Right.
So those cities have embraced that. Those markets have embraced that. So well done to the CEBL. And mm-hmm. we hope they continue to grow. We've talked a lot of Canada basketball, Dwight, and we love that here on Canada Hoops, you know, especially with guests that have played for the program like yourself. Right. You mentioned a lot of just what it meant to play for the program. You know, just obviously I would imagine, you know, being an Olympian is a highlight of your career. Just in a roundabout way, just talk about the program, what it means to you. And we've talked about Jack Donahue and just playing for Coach Donahue before I get in some more questions, man.
Well, listen, I also have to acknowledge the staff. It was Jack Donahue. It was It was Steve Konchalski. It was Doc Ryan. I played for Ken Shields. I played for what's his name now? The Lakers. Oh, man, I'm forgetting because I'm drawing a blank. Coached the Lakers with Kobe and Shaq, Dell Harris.
Right, right.
Played for Dell Harris. Played for some great, great coaches along the way. Had some great teammates. I must acknowledge my 1988 teammates. All the friendships that I've cultivated throughout the way. Canada basketball means a ton to me. Like I said, I am not employed by the program, by the organization, but I make sure to entrench myself in the organization. I'm on the phone a lot with Rowan Barrett Sr. I give him my opinions as to how the roster should be constructed. Nice. And I think I have enough credibility to where he will listen to me. Of course, ultimately, it is his decision. But do we bounce names off of each other back and forth? Absolutely. And the mere fact that Rowan calls me often and we speak often, of course, we talk about other stuff as well. But basketball is the hub of all of our conversations. And we speak. And it's just, again, all the great coaches I've had, all the great players that I've had, all the lifelong friendships that have been cultivated. I cannot say it enough how much the program means to me. I've seen the program change. I've seen the program go through a lot of changes, be it positive or negative. There have been some controversial years that I went through personally that I know a lot of my teammates went through personally. And that's why there were some ill feelings, if you will, if you want me to keep it real, towards the program, right, which is why some of the alumni have felt some sort of way throughout the years. But again, the reunion that we had before training camp, before our 2024 team went off to Paris to participate in the Olympics, I think that contributed to a lot of forgiveness, a lot of healing. People got a chance to speak and to get stuff off their chests. It was very emotional. And I want to thank Michael Bartlett, Rowan Barrett Sr., the entire Canada Basketball organization for having the wherewithal to get us together. It was in a short amount of time, but I think it was necessary because there are players out there, alumni out there, that felt disconnected from the program. But again, that Canada Basketball has done everything. They've gone above and beyond reproach to where they wanted to make sure that the Canada Basketball family was inclusive, that there was no discrimination. Again, a lot of controversial stuff happened back in the day, especially being a person of color. I went through some trials and tribulations, if you will, as a part of the program. I'm not the only one, but I can speak on myself. I don't want to speak for other people, but it wasn't easy. Right. So to see the program where it is today, from where I was when I started, it's very gratifying, a lot of changes, and it's many, many positives going in the right direction. And I think that's why Canada Basketball is going to be successful, not only on the court, but off the court as well. Diversity has been a major, major part of why Canada Basketball has been so successful as of late.
You mentioned Rowan Barrett a lot, done a lot for the program, both as a player and now as a GM role. Like, I'm wondering, you know, who did you, and he probably stands out, but who else did you really grow close with as a teammate through all your time at the program? Maybe a guy that you didn't know as well, but got to really know through your time with camps or teams or tournaments. Who's a guy or two that stands out for you, man?
Well, the thing is, you know, you're putting me on the spot because I want to be able to mention everybody, right? Of course, my entire 1988 team, I have a great affinity for. I love all of these gentlemen, the coaching staff. And please, if I forget anybody, if you could help me out, it'd be greatly appreciated. But the late, great Eli Pasquale, Jay Triano, Carl Tillman, Dave Turcotte, Al Chris Manson, Barry Munger, Norm Clark, Rommel Raffin, Greg Wilcher, Gerald Kazanowski, Bill Wennington, Martin Keene, Keith Vassell, Bobby Allen,
legends.
You know, legends. Michael Meeks.
Oh my goodness!
There's so many players. Of course, Deion George, Peter Walcott, Trevor Williams, Wayne Yearwood. I'm sure I mentioned him already. Yeah. Rowan Barrett Sr., Joey Vickery, Ron McMahon, just Steve Nash. The lists go on and on. I'm friends with a lot of these guys still today. Howard Kelsey, just Bill Wennington, Mike Schmreck. There's just so many players that have come across my way. I know I'm forgetting some people, and please forgive me. It's not because I don't think about you all. It's just that I'm trying to run the names in my head right now. But I am very appreciative of the relationships that we've maintained. We don't speak often, but we still do speak. And with the addition of social media, being able to just find people on Facebook, on Instagram, on Twitter, on, you know, TikTok, whatever forms of social media are out there, we can be found now. And it's great to have these conversations. It's JD Jackson, Spencer McKay, Corey Hallis, and it's just so many people that
I love it, man.
Tom Johnson, Ted Byrne, man, there's just so many people that I just want to give a shout out to. And again, please, I'm trying to remember all the names here. Trust me, this is not for lack of trying. I love you all. You guys have had a major, major impact on my life, and it's. I want to make sure that you guys know this. I get emotional sometimes just talking about it because I sometimes just sit back and pinch myself saying, you know what, Dwight? Canada Basketball changed your life, man. Changed your life. Being able to travel the world, being able to play in these huge arenas before thousands and thousands of people, to be recognized as one of the best players to ever come out of this country. I can't thank the coaches, the medical staffs, just everybody involved with Canada basketball. Thank you very much from the bottom of my heart. You guys have shaped me. This is it's who I am, man. It's when I talk basketball, I'm known as Canada basketball Olympian Dwight Walton. So right. That's the I've had some other successes, but the credibility comes from Canada basketball. And I can't thank the organization, the coaches, the players, the front office, the medical staff, the therapist, whomever. Thank you, thank you, thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Love it, man. Like the names, and you're just icons in the game in this country. That, you know, your tenure span is with some of the greats, man. It's so cool to hear that. I wanted to ask, 1994 World Championship team in Toronto, a young Steve Nash. At that time, some of the older guys, some of the vets, like, you know, what did you guys know about this kid? And, you know, could you tell he was going to be two-time MVP Steve Nash, man? Just to speak on him, please.
And also, I want to mention, well, Rick Fox was also a teammate of mine. He was on that 94 team.
Yes,
he was. But let me tell you about Steve Nash. Incredible. The first time, I'd never heard of him. The first time I saw him was in 1992.
Okay.
He was, I want to say, 15 or 16. And I know that we had Eli Pasquale, Ron McMahon, and Trevor Williams as our point guards. And I love and respect those three men dearly. All right? I know I'm setting this question, this response up here.
Yeah.
But this young, brash 15 or 16-year-old kid had played either rugby or soccer the morning of our first afternoon workout on Vancouver Island.
Right.
Gets on the ferry, comes to Victoria. Young, brash, confident kid. We're doing the beep test. Keep in mind, I forget if it was rugby or soccer. He played that in the morning. He went toe to toe. Anyone that knows the beep test knows how that is the ultimate, along with the VO2 max test with that big old mask over your face.
Yeah.
The beep test is the ultimate in testing your conditioning. Steve Nash went toe to toe with Dave Turcotte. They both finished with high numbers. I was like, okay. That's one part.
Yeah.
Then the basketball part started. And again, we had three great point guards, Eli Pasquale, Ron McMahon, and Trevor Williams as our point guards. If you ask me to this day, Steve Nash should have made our team as a 15 or 16-year-old.
Wow.
That's how I knew this kid was special.
Right.
He was terrific. The only reason Ken Shields, the head coach then, didn't keep him is because of his age. I'm telling you, it was a respect thing, if you will. But if you just looked at how he played, how his team won all the scrimmages, how he led a bunch of men as a teenager, he should have made our team. Wow. Again, that's my opinion. Other guys may have something else to say, which I'm sure.
Right.
And again, I am not trying to disrespect or discredit Eli Pasquale, Ron McMahon, and Trevor Williams. They are all great players. Please let me say that loud and clear.
For sure.
All great players. But Steve Nash was as good, at the very least, was as good as they were in camp, and deserved to make our team as a then 15 or 16-year-old. That's a tough. Leo Routens as well. He's another one. I can't forget him.
Yeah, yeah.
Very, very important.
Right.
Leo made our team as a 16-year-old. So should Steve Nash. He should have. Again, my opinion.
Wow, incredible. It's incredible. I mean, I know for my, you know, I'm in my early 40s. Steve's my guy, right? Just in terms of the game. And
he's my guy. He's my dude too, man. Yep,
yeah,
yep.
Love it. I just got to ask, the NBA representation, because it kind of goes along with Canada basketball, because the guys have suited up for the program, but so much NBA talent out of Montreal now, and they're also playing for Canada basketball, which is incredible. There's got to be a lot of pride with that for everybody in the Montreal basketball community, and I know so many guys have paved the way like yourself, and I know I read an article there, you know, Chris Boucher recognized your impact, and I see guys like Lou Dort playing for the program, which is incredible. Kem making the team this summer, which I thought was great, and Kem battled back, and back to Joel Anthony. Just talk about the Montreal pride throughout the NBA now, Dwight, and obviously with Canada basketball, man.
Listen, if I can, again, I don't want to forget names, but if I may, I want to recognize all the players with Montreal roots that I've had, whether it was a cup of coffee or a lengthy NBA career, going back to Stu Granger, Bill, three-time NBA champion Bill Wennington, two-time NBA champion Joel Anthony, Samuel Delambert, Chris Joseph, Kem Birch, Ben Mathurin, Chris Boucher, Lou Gens Dort. I want to say my godson, Keyshawn George, is de facto from Montreal.
Yeah.
Yes, he was born and raised in Switzerland.
Yeah.
But his father, Dion George, one of the best players to ever come out of this city and this province of Quebec. Keyshawn is also Canadian-Swiss. He has Montreal roots. The list goes on and on. We've had some great, great players. We've always had that that Quebec-Ontario rivalry. We're always striving for the respect, and we're more than handling our own right now. We've got great players coming up through the grapevine. We've got great grassroots coaching, not only here in Quebec, but throughout the country. Canada basketball is definitely recognized. It's definitely on the global stage. It's definitely on the map. We're going to have some very successful international competitions coming up in the future, and these Montreal players are a major part of the success. Again, if I forgot any names, please forgive me, but I think I got all of them. I just want to make sure that they are recognized. And again, it is with great pride that I talk about these players. I go out of my way to make sure that they are mentioned. I may not know all of them personally in a good way, like in terms of having a relationship, but we are definitely aware of each other, and we definitely give each other a pound and a handshake when we see each other, because they recognize that there were people before them, and they make sure that they acknowledge us and have a great reverence and respect for us. And that's all we can ask for. Again, I think it's just all of our responsibilities to have somewhat of an impact for the youth that are coming up throughout the ranks here. And again, both on the men's and women's side, little boys and girls. And the avenues, the opportunities have now, they've opened, the floodgates have opened.
Yeah.
Whether you want to play university basketball in Canada, in the U.S., prep school in Canada, or the U.S., play collegiately in Canada or the U.S., the avenues are open. Everybody now, the ultimate goal is to reach the pinnacle of the sport, whether it be in the WNBA or in the NBA, and of course, have the avenue of playing professionally overseas, anywhere. Right. Whenever they can get a job, if they can continue their careers, they want to. But again, Montreal has definitely put themselves on the map. I'm proud to see these guys play. I'm proud to say that I know all of these guys, that I talk to these guys, and they are a true inspiration, not only to me, but most importantly, the young kids around here in Montreal, the province of Quebec, because it gives them hope. They inspire them to say, you know what? If I can make it, so can you. Don't ever let anybody tell you that you can't do something. And I think these players have definitely come to the forefront and given these young people hope of knowing, you know what? I know these guys. I've seen them in Montreal North. I've seen them in Côte de Neige. I've seen them in LaSalle. I've seen them in NDG. They've played in these tournaments. Right. I've seen them. I've got to see them. And now they're playing professionally, whether it be overseas or at the pinnacle in the NBA. I want to be just like them. I want to be able to have a legacy of my own, if you will. So as long as these guys are playing out there, they're going to have a major, major impact on our young people. That's for sure.
Yeah, well said. The representation is incredible, really across the country. But you think about Montreal as of late.
Oh, it's fantastic.
And obviously Toronto. All right, Dwight, who is your top five or favorite five of all time for Canada basketball, man?
Okay, this is not a cop-out.
You can throw yourself in it too if you want, man.
So, thank you. No, it's going to be a two-part response because, again, I said it earlier, but I want to make sure all of my teammates on the 88 Olympic team.
Cool, yeah.
Right? I know that's more than five, but it's, again, it's Eli Pasquale, it's Norm Clark, it's Carl Tillman, it's Jay Triano, it's Al Chris Manson, it's Gerald Kazanowski, Barry Munger, Rommel Raffin, Wayne Yearwood, David Turcotte. These guys, the coaching staff, Jack Donahue, the late, great Jack Donahue, Steve Konchalski, Doc Ryan, the medical staff, the physical therapist. Those are my favorites because we went through a lot to qualify. John Hatch, excuse me, he was also on the team as well. These guys are very, very important to me. But if I have to break it down to my favorite five.
You sure?
Woo! You're putting me on the spot here.
So many great choices, man.
Yes. Steve Nash, for sure,
yeah,
at the point guard position, although Eli Pasquale was great in his own right. At the two guard is Jay Triano and Rowan Barrett Sr. for me.
Nice.
Right? Those are the two. At the three, whew, boy, that's a tough one. You know what? I'm going to throw Bobby Allen in there because cool. Bobby Allen, for those that don't know, he might go down as the best scorer of the basketball in Canadian basketball history. And that includes some NBA players. All right? And yeah. I've seen it. Bobby Allen was, as the kids say today, a bucket.
Yeah.
Legit bucket. As competitive as anybody can be. Right? So if I want to throw him on the perimeter, whether he plays the two or the three, he's going to be there for me. Right? At the four, man, there's so many, man. It's just driving me crazy here to even try to think of it. There's my teammate Wayne Yearwood. There's Gerald Kazanowski. There's Barry, all these guys, man. That I've got Michael Meeks.
Yeah,
man, it's so many guys, right? It's and then at the five, you name it, man. There's Greg Wilcher. There's Rommel Raffin. There's Spencer McKay. Shoot, there's so many guys. I you know what? I don't want to leave anybody out. So I guess it's kind of a cop-out response, but. You know, there's a Hall of Famer that, like I said, there's Steve Nash, there's Rowan Barrett, there's just so many guys, man. And I know guys are going to be watching this podcast say, why did you say my name? Well, you know what? I have nothing but love and respect for all you guys. I try to include all of you guys, but all I'm saying is you guys have had a major, major impact on my life. I love you guys dearly. I will forever bleed red and white for as long as I live. I will be in full support of Canada basketball for as long as I live. And I want that to be known. Canada basketball, it hasn't been great all the time, but there's definitely steps in the right direction. I like the direction of the program. I think things have changed a lot, and I am on board fully with this. I'm forgetting one name. Sorry. Tony Sims, you're also my teammate.
Nice.
He's also on that list, man. Yeah. Tony, one of the best athletes to come out of this country, period. Great defensive player, hyper-competitive, strong as an ox. Just love that guy dearly. Just had some great teammates throughout the years. It's been great, man. It's been great. And I can't thank everyone enough. Trust me, you guys are special to me. It's been a special time for me to be able to be a part of Canada basketball and its history.
Yeah, I know it's a difficult question, but I love asking it, Dwight. Like, I mean, there's so many, you know, I have a favorite, maybe personal five. Are they the top five? Probably not, but I got people that I love watching with the program, you know, and so I love asking that question, man. I really do.
You know what, if you really want me to break it down, it will probably be Steve Nash at the one.
Yeah.
Jay Triano and Rowan Barrett at the two. Leo Routon's at the three. I have to have Bobby Allen in there.
Yeah.
Wayne Yearwood, Michael Meeks at the four. And then at the five, there's Wilt. There's Rommel Rapp. There's so many players, man. It is what it is. You know, also there's Juan Mendez from Montreal. There are so many, many people, man, that I can name right now that are my friends to this date, and that have come through Canada basketball, have just memories and have had a major impact on my life.
Yeah, no doubt. I love it, man. Who should join us on Canada Hoops? Who's got a good Canada basketball story to share with us? And we've been fortunate. We've had some, you've mentioned people. I mean, Jay has joined us, Juan, so many others, but who's got a good Canada basketball story to share with us, man? And maybe help me connect with them too.
Yeah. Have you spoken with Wayne Yearwood? Have you spoken with Wayne?
I have not. No.
Have you spoken with Norm Clark?
No.
Okay. Well, the reason why I mentioned those two specifically, and again, I don't want to put any other thoughts about the program, but they will have their own perspective.
Right.
If they're willing to speak about it, they had a good time with Canada basketball, but they will have their own perspective as well.
Right.
They are Black, again, and we had a different experience. All right. I don't want to sugarcoat it.
Right.
We went through a lot with Canada basketball. It strengthened us, I can tell you that. We saw some things that we didn't like. And I need to speak about it. I have spoken about it on other platforms, but I can't sit here and say truthfully that it didn't go, my tenure didn't go without some issues,
right,
some controversies. I dealt with it. It wasn't easy. I think I held some of it in, but it wasn't easy. I can tell you that. It's still in my brain. It's a part of my journey. And when I give you the names of Wayne Yearwood and Norm Clark, and there are others out there as well, Tony Sims, they can give you their story, if you will. They are very proud members of Canada basketball. So please let me make sure I get that in there.
Right.
But they will have their own perspective as to how their journey went, both good and bad, with this organization.
No, I appreciate that, man. I mean, I know there'd been research talking to Oren Weisfeld there, a friend of ours too, that's a journalist and working on a book. And that was something he had mentioned to me in all the conversations and the interviews with people throughout Canada basketball, was the unfortunate part that maybe class and race played throughout the program. And from our conversation today, it seems like, you know, the gathering of the alumni was some healing of that. And now the program is at a much better place, and the program recognizes maybe what did occur and how, you know, they're making sure that doesn't occur anymore. And so, you know, we truly appreciate you sharing that with us. And, you know, it was an honor and a privilege to hear you speak today, man. It really was.
No, and again, Matty, I truly appreciate you reaching out to me. I know you have other individuals to get to that you want to interview, but if you want to bring me on again, I will be more than happy.
Definitely.
To engage with you with NBA talk about ball around the world.
Yeah.
Anything you name it, we could discuss it. But again, I'm very thankful and appreciative for you reaching out to me and having me on your very esteemed podcast. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you.
No, we appreciate you, man. That's a wrap on another episode of Canada Hoops. I want to thank Dwight Walton for pulling up. Thank you for listening. Remember to rate and review us wherever you get your podcast. Check out our YouTube channel. Hit us up on Instagram and X.com. Keep supporting Canada basketball and our Canadian Hoopers. And we will see you on the next episode.